हेलो गाइस, वी विल स्टार्ट विद द चैप्टर नंबर 3 ऑफ बेली, वूंड्स हीलिंग एंड टिश्यू रिपेयर. वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट चैप्टर्स एज पर द नीट सुपर स्पेशलिटी एंड नीट पोस्ट ग्रेजुएशन एंट्रेंस एग्जाम्स. इंट्रोडक्शन पार्ट. द वूंड हीलिंग इज अ मैकेनिज्म वेयर बाय द बॉडी अटेम्प्ट्स टू रिस्टोर द इंटीग्रिटी ऑफ द इंजर्ड पार्ट. दिस फॉल्स far short of tissue regeneration by pluripotent cells seen in some amphibians and is often detrimental as seen in the problems created by scarring, adhesions, keloids, contractures and cirrhosis of the liver. So basically cirrhosis of the liver also comes under healing. Several factors may influence healing. However, a clean incised wound in a healthy person where there is no skin loss will follow a set patterns as outlined below. The factors influencing the healing of wound: site, structures of involved, mechanism of wounding, whether it is incision, crush or crush avulsion, contamination, foreign bodies or bacteria involved, loss of tissue, and other local factors like vascular insufficiency, can be arterial or venous, previous radiations, pressure, or systemic factors like malnutrition or vitamin and mineral deficiencies, disease, medications, immune deficiencies, and smoking. Also, if you see diabetes, steroids, AIDS, chemotherapy, they all are factors which affect the wound healing. A very important summary box. Site, structures, incision, crush or crush avulsion, what is the mechanism of wounding, the contamination, loss if any there, vascular insufficiency if there is, previous radiations, pressure, malnutrition, diabetes, steroid, AIDS, chemo, smoking. Normal wound healing. The normal wound healing, we just saw that a clean incised wound in a healthy person, there is no skin loss, this is a set pattern. Okay, so there are three phases: inflammatory phase, proliferative phase, and remodeling phase, which is also known as the maturing phase. Occasionally a hemostatic phase is referred to as occurring before the inflammatory phase. There is a hemostatic phase also which is occurring before the inflammatory phase, or a destructive phase following the inflammation consisting of a cellular cleansing of the wound by macrophages. The inflammatory phase begins immediately after wounding and lasts 2 to 3 days. Important MCQ. Bleeding is followed by vasoconstriction and thrombus formation to limit the blood loss. Platelets are sticking to the damaged endothelial of the vessel and releasing the ADP, which causes the thrombocytic aggregates to fill the wound. So ADP is important, platelet aggregates and thrombus formation 2 to 3 days, and begins immediately after, and vasoconstriction. They all are the keywords which can be seen in the upcoming exams. So next, when bleeding stops, the platelet then releases several cytokines from their alpha granules. These are platelet derived, which are those cytokines. First is platelet derived growth factor, second is platelet factor 4 and transforming growth factor beta, TGF beta. And these attract the inflammatory cells such as the polymorphonuclear cells. They attract the PMNs and macrophages, and platelets and the local injured tissue release the vasoactive amines, such as the histamine, serotonin and prostaglandin. What are those? Histamine, serotonin and prostaglandin, and they increase the vascular permeability, obviously, and thereby aiding the infiltration of these inflammatory cells. Macrophage remove devitalized tissue and microorganism while regulating the fibroblast activity in the proliferative phase. This is also a keyword, guys. Proliferative phase, fibroblast. inflammatory phase, platelets. So the initial framework for structural support of cells is provided by the fibrin produced by the fibrinogen. A more historical description of this phase is described in four words, which is rubor, tumor, calor, and dollar. The proliferative phase lasts from the third day or from the third week, 3 day to 3 week, consisting mainly of the fibroblast activity with the production of collagen and ground substance, that is glycosaminoglycans and proteoglycans. The growth of new blood vessels as capillary loops, which is known as the angiogenesis, and the re-epithelialization of the wound surface. The fibroblasts require vitamin C to produce the collagen. The wound tissue formed in the early part of this phase is called as granulation tissue. In the later part of the phase, this is an increase in the tensile strength. In the later part of the second phase, which is the phase of fibroblasts, which is also known as the proliferative phase. The proliferative phase is in the later part of this proliferative phase, there is an increase in the tensile strength of the wound due to increased collagen, which is at first deposited in the random fashion and consists of type 3 collagen. So in inflammatory phase there is platelet, in proliferative phase it is fibroblasts, and these fibroblasts are causing the deposition of type 3 collagen. So this proliferative phase with this increase in collagen deposition is associated with wound contraction. So wound contraction starts in proliferative phase, which can considerably reduce the surface area of the wound over the first 3 weeks of healing. Then comes your remodeling phase, is characterized by maturation of collagen, important MCQ. Type 1 replacing type 3 until a ratio of 4:1 achieved. 4:1, type 1 will replace type 3. So in inflammatory phase, platelet, in proliferative phase, there is type 3 collagen, and in remodeling phase, there is type 1 collagen. So there is a realignment of collagen fibers along the lines of tension, decrease the wound vascularity. All are potential MCQs, decreasing wound vascularity and wound contracture due to the fibroblast and myofibroblast activity. This maturation of collagen leads to increased tensile strength in the wound, which is maximum at 12 weeks post injury and represents approximately 80% of the uninjured skin strength. So your 100% strength will never be achieved. It will be the maximum by 80% at 12th week. Now normal healing in a specific tissues. First is bone. The phases are as above, but periosteal and endosteal proliferation leads to the formation of callus, which is an immature bone consisting of osteoid, which is mineralized by hydroxyapatite and laid down by osteoblasts. So in the remodeling phase, cortical structure and the medullary cavity are restored. If fracture ends are accurately opposed and rigidly fixed, the callus formation is minimal. And this is an important MCQ. If fracture ends are accurately opposed and rigidly fixed, the callus formation is minimal and primary healing occurs. So if a gap exists, then secondary healing. It may lead to the delayed union, non-union or malunion. Nerve. Distal to the wound, Wallerian degeneration. What happens? Wallerian degeneration. It is not proximal, it is distal to the wound. So proximally, the nerve suffers traumatic degeneration as far as the last node of Ranvier. This is also important. Up to what extent the nerve will suffer traumatic degeneration? It will be till the last node of Ranvier, and distal to the wound, Wallerian degeneration. Proximal to the wound, nerve traumatic degeneration till the last node of Ranvier. Then the regeneration nerve fibers are attracted to their receptors by neurotropism. There is neurotropism, which is mediated by growth factors, hormones and other extracellular matrix trophins. Nerve regeneration is characterized by profuse growth of new growth nerve fibers which sprout from the cut proximal end. Otherwise, overgrowth of these coupled with poor approximation may lead to neuroma formation. Tendon. Although the tendon repair follows a normal pattern of wound healing, there are two main mechanisms whereby nutrients, cells and new vessels reach the severed tendon. These are the intrinsic, which consist of vincular blood flow and synovial diffusion, and extrinsic, which depends on the formation of fibrous adhesions between the tendon and the tendon sheath. There are two mechanisms by which the tendon is repaired. One is intrinsic and another is the extrinsic. The intrinsic factor is the factor which consists of vincular blood flow, synovial diffusion, and extrinsic are the factors which depend on the formation of fibrous adhesions between the tendon and the tendon sheath. The random nature of the initial collagen produced means that the tendon lacks tensile strength for at least tendon lacks the tensile strength for at least 3 to 6 weeks, while your wound was having till the 12th week, but tendon is having for the first 3 to 6 weeks. Active mobilization prevents the adhesion. Very important. Active mobilization, usually in bone we say that we have to reduce the mobilization, but no, in case of tendon, there is active mobilization required. It prevents adhesion, limiting range of the motion, but the tendon must be protected by splinting in order to avoid a rupture of the repair. So there should be active mobilization to prevent adhesion, as well as there should be splintage in order to avoid the rupture of the repair. Abnormal healing. What is abnormal healing? Some of the adverse influences on wound healing are listed in summary box 3.1. Summary box 3.1, we saw what are the factors influencing the healing of the wound. And we forgot to see this image. These are the phases of healing. First is the early inflammatory phase. This is the early inflammatory phase, in which the platelet enriched blood clot and dilated vessels. The vessels are dilated. There is platelet enriched blood clot. Then there is late inflammation and late inflammation inflammatory phase with increased vascularity and increase in PMNs and lymphocytes, which are the round cells. So these are the round cells and PMNs, and there is basically increased vascularity. New vessels have been formed here. Then comes your proliferative phase, in which you can see the fibroblasts or myofibroblasts are there. Then there is mature contracted scar. If you look at the summary box 3.2, it is stating the classification of wound closure and healing. It is by primary intention, secondary intention, or by tertiary intention. Very important table here. What is primary intention? Primary intention, when your wound edges are opposed, it is a normal healing with minimal scar. It is seen often in the surgical incisions. What is secondary intention? When your wound is left open and when it heals by granulation, contraction and epithelialization, and there is increased inflammation and proliferation and scar is poor. Tertiary intention is basically delayed primary intention, a very important MCQ. Tertiary intention is basically delayed primary intention. In this, there is wound is initially left open, but later on the edges are opposed when healing conditions are favorable. Then delayed healing may result in loss of function or poor cosmetic outcome. The aim of the treatment is to achieve healing by primary intention. This should be your aim, to achieve healing by primary intention, and so reduce the inflammation and proliferative responses. Healing by primary intention is also known as healing by first intention. This occurs when there is opposition of the wound edges and minimal surrounding tissue trauma that causes least inflammation and leaves the best scar. Primary intention. delayed primary intention is also known as tertiary intention. In delayed primary intention, the healing occurs when the wound edges are not opposed immediately, which may be necessary in contaminated or untidy wound. You have to reduce the contamination in order to have a better healing. The inflammatory and proliferative phases of the healing are well established when delayed closure of the wound is carried out. The inflammatory and proliferative phases of healing are well established when delayed closure of the wound is carried out. So there is also called, this is also called healing by tertiary intention. The delayed primary is also known as tertiary intention in some texts, and will result in a less satisfactory scar that would result after healing by primary intention. So secondary intention or healing by secondary intention occurs in wounds that are left open and allowed to heal by granulation, contraction and epithelialization. Now we will see the types of wound, tidy versus untidy, the site injured, the structures involved in the injury and the mechanism of injury, incised or explosion. All influence healing and recovery of function. This has led to the management of wound based upon their classification into untidy and tidy wounds. This is a diagram of a tidy and untidy wound, and which is a tidy untidy avulsed wound. Right side the diagram, you can see the facial trauma with an apparent skin tissue loss, but none found after the careful matching. Actually, when you carefully match the tissue, there was no loss at all, which was initially looking at apparent loss. The surgeon's aim is to convert the untidy to tidy by removing all the contaminated and devitalized tissue. Primary repair of all structures, which is bone, tendon, vessel and nerve, it may be possible in a tidy wound. Very important. Primary repair you can do of the bone, tendon and vessel and nerve only in a tidy wound. But a contaminated wound with dead tissue requires debridement on one or several occasions before definite repair can be carried out. This is the concept of second look surgery. We have done many times, we might have done many times the second look surgery, but we didn't know that primary repair of all structures is possible only in tidy wound. This is especially true in the injuries caused by explosion, bullets or other missiles, where the extent where the external wound itself may appear much smaller than the wider extent of the injured tissue deep to the surface. Multiple debridements are often carried out after crushing injuries in road traffic accidents or in natural disasters such as earthquakes, where fallen masonry causes the widespread muscle damage and compartment syndrome. We will see in the later part of the chapter. Any explosion where there are multiple victims are at the same site, or where there have been a suicide related explosion, will carry the risk of tissue and viral contamination. One tissue of one person will contaminate the other person when there is suicide bombing or multiple victims are present at the explosion site. Appropriate tests for the hepatitis virus and HIV are required. Okay, so appropriate HIV and hepatitis virus tests are required when you are dealing with an explosion which is involving multiple injuries, multiple trauma, and when there is a suicide bombing. Tidy versus untidy wound. Tidy is an incised wound. It is a clean wound. The tissue are healthy and there is seldom tissue loss. What is untidy? It is a crushed or avulsed wound, contaminated wound. The devitalized tissue is present and often there is tissue loss. So how will you manage the acute wound? The surgeon must remember to examine the whole patient according to acute life trauma support, ATLS principle. A stab wound in the back can be missed just as easily in the reality of the accident and emergency room as in fictitious detective novel. The wound itself should be examined, taking into consideration the site and the possible structures damaged. It is essential to assess the movement and sensations while watching for pain and listening to the patient. So tetanus cover should be noted. Very important, tetanus cover. We should always remember the tetanus cover at the time of managing the acute wound, and appropriate treatment carried out. A bleeding wound should be elevated and a pressure pad applied clamps should not be put on vessels blindly. You should not put the clamps blindly because nerve damage is likely and vascular anastomosis is rendered impossible. If you will put tight clamps over the bleeding vessel, then you may make that vessel impossible to repair. In order to facilitate examination, adequate analgesia and anesthesia and or anesthesia that may be local, regional or general are required. General anesthesia is often needed in children with limb injuries, particularly those of the hand. A tourniquet should be applied in order to facilitate visualization of all structures. Due care should be taken with tourniquet application, avoiding uneven pressure and noting the duration of tourniquet time. After assessment, a thorough debridement is essential. Abrasion, road rash following a fall from the motorbike and explosion all cause dirt tattooing and they require the use of scrubbing brush or even the excision under magnification. A wound should be explored and debrided to the limit of blood staining. Devitalized tissues must be excised until bleeding occurs, with the obvious exception of nerves, vessels and tendons. These may survive with adequate revascularization subsequently or after being covered with viable tissue such as that brought in by skin or muscle flaps. The use of copious saline irrigation, very important, the use of copious saline irrigation or pulsed jet lavage where the instrumentation is available can be less destructive than a knife or scissor when debriding. When you are debriding a tissue, it's better to use the copious saline irrigation or pulsed jet lavage. However, pulsed jet lavage can implant dirt into a deeper plane and it should be used carefully. Muscle viability is judged by the very important MCQ. Muscle viability is judged by the color, bleeding pattern and contractility. Color, bleeding pattern and contractility. It has been asked previously. In a tidy wound, repair of all damaged structures must be attempted. A very important MCQ is coming up, that repair of nerves under magnification using 80 or 10-0 monofilament nylon is used. As straight forward question has been asked previously, 80 or 10-0 monofilament nylon. So vessel such as the radial or ulnar artery may be repaired using similar techniques. Tendon repairs, particularly those in hand, benefit from early active mobilization because this minimizes the adhesion between the tendon and the tendon sheath. Skin cover by flap or graft may be required, as skin closure should always be without tension and should allow for the edema typically associated with injury and inflammatory phase of healing. A flap brings in a new blood supply and can be used to cover the tendon, nerve, bone and other structures that would not provide a suitable vascular base for the skin graft. You should not place a vascular graft just directly on a tendon, nerve, bone or other structures. You should put a flap over there, not a skin graft. So a skin graft has no inherent blood supply and is dependent on the recipient site for nutrition. You all know that. Bites. Most bites involve either puncture wounds or avulsions. Bite from small animal are common in children and require cleansing and treatment according to the principles outlined in summary 3.3. Which is summary 3.3 box? This is the management of acute wound. This is the management of acute wound. Cleansing, exploration and diagnosis, debridement, repair of structures, replacement of lost tissue when indicated, skin cover, skin closure without tension, all of the above with careful handling and meticulous technique. Not a very good MCQ point here, just to read. Also the figure 3.4, the bite in the animal. This is the degloving injury. This is the dog bite in a child. So animal bites are common in children, they want to say. Okay. So injuries to the ear, tip of nose and lower lip are most usually seen in victims of human bite. So human will bite at ear, which has been seen by Suarez. Tip of nose and lower lip. Lower lip, the very loving animals. Okay. So a boxing type injury of the metacarpophalangeal joint may result from a perforating contact with the teeth of victim. Boxing type injury in metacarpophalangeal joint. Anaerobic and aerobic organism prophylaxis is required, as bite typically have high virulent. You have to give a good prophylactic cover when you are dealing with the bite. Puncture wounds. Wounds by a sharp subjects should be explored to the time of tissue blood staining. Needle stick injuries should be treated according to the well-established protocols based on the hepatitis and HIV risk. X-ray examination should be carried out in order to rule out or retain foreign bodies in the depth of the wound. Hematoma. If large, painful, or causing the neural deficit, a hematoma may require release by incision or aspiration. When it is large, when it is painful, when it is causing neurological deficits. So, hematoma may require incision or aspiration. So, in the gluteal or thigh region, there has been associated disruption of fat, known as the fat fracture. Where is fat fracture seen? Gluteal or thigh regions. When your police personnel beat the thieves or the people on gluteal region or thigh, there is fat fracture, which results in a very unsightly groove but intact skin. An untreated hematoma may also calcify and therefore require surgical exploration if symptomatic. What is degloving injury? So degloving occurs when the skin and the subcutaneous fat are stripped by avulsion from the underlying fascia. Very important and potent MCQ. What underlying fascia? Skin and subcutaneous fat, they are stripped of underlying fascia, leaving the neurovascular structures, tendon and bone exposing the neurovascular structures, tendon and bones. A degloving injury may be open or closed. An obvious example of an open degloving is a ring avulsion, when your ring has been stuck into some motor and it has totally degloved your finger with loss of finger skin. This is a degloving injury with the loss of finger skin. This is the degloving buttock injury, when a bike has passed above that. A close degloving may be a rollover injury, typically caused by motor vehicle over a limb. Such an injury will extend far further than expected, and much of limb skin may be non-viable, guys. So examination under anesthesia is required with a radical excision of all non-bleeding skin as judged by bleeding dermis. You have to excise till the bleeding is there. You can use fluorescein. It can be used intravenously while the patient is anesthetized. Under ultraviolet light, you have to see the viable skin, which will show up as fluorescent yellowish green color, and the non-viable skin, which is I don't know which color. So yellowish green color is the viable skin. When your fluorescent dye is used intravenously. Three key points. Next, however, the main objection of this method is that of possible anaphylactic shock. There is a possibility of anaphylactic shock while giving the fluorescein dye. Due to the fluorescein sensitivity, most surgeons therefore rely upon serial excision until the punctate dermal bleeding. This is an important word, punctate dermal bleeding. Split skin grafts can be harvested from the dye. You can use your avulsed or degloved skin for split skin graft. It can be harvested from the degloved non-viable part and meshed to cover the raw areas resulting from debridement. Compartment syndrome, a very, very, very important topic कंपार्टमेंट सिंड्रोम. कंपार्टमेंट सिंड्रोम इज बेसिकली अकर इन क्लोज्ड लोअर लिम इंजरीज. दे आर कैरेक्टराइज बाय सीवियर पेन, पेन ऑन पैसिव मूवमेंट ऑफ अफेक्टेड कंपार्टमेंट मसल, डिस्टल सेंसरी डिस्टर्बेंस एंड फाइनली बाय द एब्सेंस. फाइनली, फाइनली हैव यू रेड द वर्ड फाइनली? सो इट इज फाइनली बाय द एब्सेंस ऑफ पल्सेस डिस्टली. दिस इज द लास्ट साइन. फर्स्ट साइन इज पेन ऑफ पैसिव मूवमेंट ऑफ अफेक्टेड कंपार्टमेंट मसल, पेन ऑन पैसिव स्ट्रेचिंग. So they can occur with an open injury if the wound does not extend into the affected compartment. So you cannot say that only closed injuries can cause compartment syndrome. They can also occur with an open injury. Each and every sentence of Bailey is important. Each and every sentence, each and every word. So how will you measure the compartment pressure? The compartment pressure can be measured using a pressure monitor and a catheter placed in the muscle compartment. If pressures are constantly greater than 30 millimeter of mercury, or if the above clinical signs are present, then fasciotomy. When will you do fasciotomy? You will do fasciotomy when the pressure is more than 30 millimeter of mercury. Fasciotomy involves incision of deep muscle fascia and is best carried out by longitudinal incisions of the skin. Fasciotomy is involving the deep muscle fascia and best carried out by longitudinal incision of skin, fat and fascia. So the muscle will then be seen bulging up. When will you stop? When the muscle is bulging out through the fasciotomy opening. The lower limb can be decompressed via two incisions, each being lateral to the subcutaneous border of the tibia. Basically, at lower limb, you have to give two longitudinal incisions which are parallel to each other and on the lateral part of the subcutaneous border of the tibia. So this gives access to the two posterior compartments. So you will access the two posterior compartments and to the peroneal and anterior compartment of the leg. Peroneal compartment, anterior compartment of the leg and the two posterior compartments. In crush injuries that present several days after the event, very important points is coming up. That in a crush injury that presents several days after the event, a late fasciotomy should not be done because the dead muscle produces a myoglobin that may cause myoglobinuria with glomerular blockage and kidney gone. Aap bhala karne chale the, bhai bhalai ka zamana nahi hai. Myoglobinuria, crush injuries, late fasciotomy, glomerular blockage, renal failure, myoglobinuria, better to do the amputation. Now the high pressure injection injuries. The use of high pressure devices on cleaning, degreasing and painting. When someone is cleaning, degreasing or painting with high pressure jet lavage, that may cause extensive closed injuries. Before proceeding next, we should see this diagram. This is a fasciotomy of the lower leg when a muscle is bulging out. So, we were at high pressure injection injuries. The liquid injected spreads along the facial planes, a common site being from finger to forearm. The injury can extend from finger to the forearm. So the tissue damage is dependent upon the toxicity of the substance and the injection pressure. How much is the damage? It will be decided by the injection pressure and toxicity of the substance. If substance is not very toxic, you need not to worry. If pressure was not that high, you need not to worry. The injury may not have extended to that much of the part of the limb or part of the finger. Not need to worry. So treatment is surgical. Treatment is surgical with wide exposure, removal of the toxic substance and thorough debridement. Preoperative x-rays may be helpful where air or the lead-based paint can be used. where your air or lead based paints are used, you can take x-rays. So it should be noted that amputation rates following high pressure injection injuries are reported as being 45. It's pretty high. It's pretty high. The amputation rates following high pressure injection injuries. Delayed or conservative treatment is therefore inappropriate. Chronic wounds. In chronic wounds, a chronic wound may be defined as one that fails to heal in the expected time for a wound of that type, which is usually less than 3 weeks. So chronic wound is more than 3 weeks. Delay in healing can occur in any phase, but may most often occur in the inflammatory. Most often delay is in inflammatory phase, not in proliferatory, not in remodeling. It is happening in the first phase of platelets, first phase of ADP, first phase of inflammatory phase. Leg ulcers, the most common chronic wounds are leg ulcers. An ulcer can be defined as a break in the epithelial continuity. A prolonged inflammatory phase leads to overgrowth of granulation tissue, and they will cause the fibrotic margins. The necrotic tissue, often at the ulcer center, is called slough. The more common etiologies are listed in summary box 3.4. Okay, summary box 3.4, what is it saying? What are the causes of the leg ulcer? The causes of leg ulcer, etiology of leg ulcer. First, the venous disease leading to the local venous hypertension, the varicose vein. The arterial disease, either large vessel, which is atherosclerosis, or the small vessel, which is causing diabetes. Arthritis associated with autoimmune, like rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, trauma that could be self-inflicted, chronic infection, TB or syphilis, neoplastic, obviously. These are the etiologies of leg ulcers. A chronic ulcer, unresponsive to dressing and simple treatments, should be biopsied to rule out neoplasia. You never know, it should be, it may have been a cancer, and most probably the Marjolin's ulcer, which are there in an ulcer. A cancer developing in a previous ulcer is Marjolin's ulcer, and most commonly it is in the legs. So an effective treatment of any leg ulcer depends on treating the underlying cause, and diagnosis is therefore vital. Arterial and venous circulations should be assessed, as should sensation throughout the lower limb. Arterial and venous circulations should be assessed, as should the sensations throughout the lower limb. You should check the sensations also, not only the arterial, but the sensations also. Surgical treatment is the only indicated if non-operative treatment has failed. Surgical treatment only if your non-operative treatment has failed, or if the patient suffers from intractable pain. If your question is mentioning that ulcer with intractable pain, you have to go for surgical treatment. Meshed skin graft are more successful than sheet grafts. Meshed grafts more successful than sheet grafts and have the advantage of allowing the mobilization, as any tissue exudate can escape through the mesh. It should be stressed that the recurrence rate is high in venous ulceration. Recurrence rate of ulceration of ulcerations are high in venous ulcers, and patient compliance with the regime of hygiene, elevation and elastic compression is required. If we talk about the pressure sores, then there can be a defined as tissue necrosis with ulceration due to prolonged pressure. Less preferable terms are bed sores, pressure ulcers and decubitus ulcers. They should be regarded as preventable, but occur in approximately 5% of all hospital admitted patients, ranging 3 to 12%. There is a higher incidence in paraplegic patients, in the elderly and in the severely ill patients. The most common site, very important, the most common site is IG of Shimla. The ischium is the most common site. Second, greater decanter. Least is occipital. In malleus, lateral is more common because obviously the lateral malleolus will have been under so much of pressure more than that of your medial malleolus. Sorry, the lateral malleolus will be more under pressure than the lateral malleolus. So, a staging system for description of pressure source advised by the, this is an advisory of ANPUAP. NPUAP. Okay, sorry. The staging of the pressure. Staging of the pressure source. Non-blanchable erythema. Stage 1. Stage 1 is non-blanchable erythema without a breach in the epidermis. Stage 2, partial thickness skin loss involving epidermis and dermis. 3, full thickness skin loss extending in the subcutaneous tissue but not through underlying fascia. Underlying fascia is intact in stage 3 of pressure source. Stage 4, full thickness skin loss, fascia gone. Extensive tissue destruction involving bone, muscle, tendon or joints. Again, if your pressure is 30, we just now saw that when your compartment pressure is 30, you need to open it. Again, a more 30 mm of Hg is there, that is your pressure source. When external pressure increases the capillary occlusive pressure, which is over 30 mm of mercury, blood flow to the skin ceases, leading to the tissue anoxia, necrosis and ulceration. This is a diagram of a pressure source you might have seen in your residency so much time. So, prevention is obviously the best treatment. Best treatment is actually prevention. And with good skin care, special pressure dispersion cushion of foams and the use of low air loss and air fluidized beds and urinary or fecal diversion in selected patients. Pressure sore awareness is vital and the bed bound patients very important. Very, very important that the bed bound patient should be turned up at least every 2 hours in a wheelchair every 10 seconds after every 10 minutes. So it should be stressed that the most important treatment is to treat the cause of the pressure and surgical treatment is last resort, often doomed to be failure if the cause persists. So surgical management of pressure sore follows the same principle involved in the acute wound treatment. The patient must be well motivated, clinically stable with good nutrition and adhere to the preventive measures advised post-operatively. Pre-operative management of the pressure sore involves adequate debridement and the use of vacuum assisted closure pressure minus 125 mm of mercury. It may help to provide a suitable wound for the surgical closure. The aim is to fill the dead space and to provide durable sensate skin. Large skin flaps that include muscle are best and occasionally an intact sensory innervated area can be included. Like if you want to include the sensory innervated area, use extensor fascial outer flap or lateral crenation of the thigh. If possible, use a flap that can be advanced further if there is recurrence and that does not interfere with the planning of the neighboring flap that may be used in the future. Important points about vacuum assisted closure: minus 125 mm of mercury. It is a negative pressure wound therapy, also known as negative pressure wound therapy, and the formation of granulation tissue in chronic wounds and ulcers. It is used in a foam dressing is cut to the size of the and fit to the wound. A perforated wound drain is placed over the foam. Wound is sealed. Transparent adhesion film applied. Vacuum is applied. Minus 125 mm of mercury. How it works? It works by decreasing edema, by removing the interstitial fluid, and by increasing the blood circulation. As a result, it is a bacterial counts are decreasing as a result. It is not a direct mechanism. Direct mechanism is by removing the interstitial fluid, by increasing the blood flow, by decreasing the edema. by decreasing the edema, by increasing the blood flow, by decreasing the interstitial pressure. But bacterial cell count is a secondary mechanism, and also the cell proliferation. Very important topic, the necrotizing soft tissue infection. This is rare but often fatal. They are the most commonly polymicrobial infection with gram-positive aerobes. Second one is gram-negative anaerobes. The gram-positive aerobes are staph on streptopyogenes. The gram-negative anaerobes like Escherichia coli, Pseudomonas, Clostridium and Bacteroides. And also the beta-hemolytic streptococci. So there is usually a history of trauma, a surgery with wound contamination, which is causing the necrotizing soft tissue infection. There is a history of trauma and surgery with wound contamination. So sometimes the patient's own defense mechanism may be deficient. These infections are characterized by sudden presentation and rapid progression. The fact that deeper tissue are involved often leads to late or misdiagnosis. There are two main types of necrotizing infection. One is Clostridium, second is non-Clostridium, which is caused by streptococcal gangrene and necrotizing fasciitis. Necrotizing fasciitis is very important. Streptococcus pyogenes is the cause, and known as flesh eating bug. Treatment is appropriate antibiotic with wide surgical excision. The variant of necrotizing fasciitis with toxic shock syndrome is caused by Streptococcus pyogenes and often called as flesh eating. What are the signs and symptoms of necrotizing infection? Unusual pain is there, edema beyond the area of erythema, crepitus is there, skin blistering happen, fever is absent. Very important is that fever is not there. Even though it is an infection, the fever is not there. Grayish discharge, that which is known as the dishwater pus, pink or orange skin staining, but focal skin gangrene is a late sign. Shock coagulopathy or multi-organ failure may be seen in the necrotizing infections. Tissue biopsies are required for the histological diagnosis and culture to obtain the appropriate antibiotic sensitivity information. The raw area resulting from the excision often require the skin grafting. Treatment is surgical excision with tissue biopsy being sent for the culture also and histopath also. And wide raw areas requiring skin grafting are often required. Scars. Let's talk about scars. So scars, the maturation phase of the wound healing has been discussed above and represents the formation of what is described as scar. The immature scar becomes mature scar over a period lasting a year. It takes 1 year or more for an immature scar to become a mature scar. But it is at first pink, hard, raised and often itchy. The immature scar is pink, hard, raised and itchy. The disorganized collagen fibers become aligned along stress line, with their strength being in their weave rather than in their amount. The strength is actually in their weaving, not in the amount. You cannot put more and more collagen and think that it will cause more and it will lead you more and more strength. It is not possible. It is actually the weaving which is important. As the collagen matures and becomes denser, the scar becomes almost acellular and fibroblasts in blood vessels are reduced. Acellular, mature scar is acellular. The external appearance of the scar becomes pale, while the scar becomes softer, flattens, and its itchiness diminishes. Most of these changes occur over the first 3 months. Most of the changes happening first 3 months, but a scar will continue to mature for 1 to 2 years. Tensile strength will continue to increase, but would not exceed to more than 60 to 80%, which we saw is achieved at 12th week, means after 3 months. So scars are often described as being atrophic, hypertrophic and keloid. There are three types of scars: atrophic, hypertrophic and keloid. An atrophic scar is pale, flat and stretched in appearance, often appearing on the back. Atrophic scar, pale, flat and stretched, often on back and in areas of tension. It is easily traumatized as the epidermis and dermis are thinned. It can be easily traumatized. Excision and resuturing are the treatment part. Hypertrophic scar, very important. It is defined as the excessive scar tissue that does not extend beyond the boundaries of original incision. If it extend beyond the boundaries of original incision, it is keloid. A keloid scar is defined as excessive scar tissue that extends beyond the boundaries of original incision or wound. So it results from the prolonged inflammatory. So a hypertrophic scar is basically due to a prolonged inflammatory phase and from unfavorable scar sighting. In the face, there are known to be a lines of facial expression. Then keloid. Its etiology is unknown, but it is associated with elevated levels of growth factors, deeply pigmented skin, and inherited tendency in certain areas of body. But what are those areas? It is marked by a triangular region, which is between the two points of each shoulder tip and the sternum. The history of both hypertrophic and keloid scar shows excess collagen and hypervascularity. The histology showing excess collagen and hypervascularity, but this is more marked in keloids, which have type 3, more and more type 3, not the type 1. Type 1 should be there, but if type 3 is increased, it is immature scar, and it can be keloid or it can be hypertrophic scar. If it is extending beyond the lines of incision, it's a keloid scar. The treatment of both hypertrophic and keloid scar is difficult and summarized in table 3.7. Very, very important table. All the points are important. How will you treat the hypertrophic and keloid scar? Pressure can be given. Local molds or elasticated garments. Silicon gel sheeting can be used. Intralesional steroid injection, very important. The excision and steroid injections. Excision and post-op radiation, you can use post-op radiation also. And all these excisions are associated with high risk of occurrences. There is a high chance of recurrence if you will do excision. Radiotherapy can also be used. Steroid injection can also be used. Silicon gel can also be used. Intralesional excision, this is for keloid only. A plain intralesional excision is for keloid only. But an excision with intralesional post-op radiotherapy is for hypertrophic and keloid scar both. Laser, you can use laser also. Laser can also be used to reduce the redness. And vitamin E, palm oil massage. It is unproven. They may give you four options, and all the four options will be here, but vitamin E and palm is not proven. Avoidable scarring is an acute wound has been managed correctly. Most of the problems described above should not occur. However, the surgeon should always stress to the patient that there will be a scar of some description after the wounding, be it planned or accidental. A dirt ingrain, that is a tattooed scar, is usually preventable by proper initial scrubbing. How will you prevent a dirt ingrained tattooed scar? By proper initial scrubbing and cleansing of the wound. Late treatment may require excision of the scar or pigment destruction by laser. Mismatched or malaligned scars result from the failure to recognize normal landmarks such as a lip vermilion. So mismatched or misaligned scar, where will you see? Seen are lip vermilions, white roll interface, eyelids, nostril free margins and hairlines such as those relaxing to eyebrows and mustaches. How will you treat? You will excise and resuture it. So poorly contoured scar can be stepped, grooved and pin cushioned. Most are caused by poor alignment of the poor scars are due to poor alignment of deep structures such as the muscle or fat. But trapped or pin cushioned scars are often unavoidable unless the almost circumferential wound can be excised initially. Late treatment consists of scar excision and correct alignment of deeper tissue structures, and in case of trapped or scar, an excision of the scar margins and repairing using W and Z plasty. Suture marks may be minimized by using monofilament sutures, and it should be removed early. If you are using monofilament sutures, they should be removed early, and sutures are given under tension will leave marks. Fine sutures, which are 6-0 or smaller, placed close to the wound margin, tend to leave less scarring. Subcuticular sutures, avoid suture mark either side of the wound or lesion. Contractures, when scar across the joint or flexion creases, a tight web may form, restricting the range of movements of the joint. This may be referred to as contracture and can cause hyperextension or hyperflexion, can anything. In the neck, it may interfere with head extension. Treatment is multiple Z-plasties. Multiple, not the Z-plasty. Read option carefully. There may be an option known as a multiple Z-plasties. Splintage and intensive physiotherapy are often required postoperatively. These are a few diagrams. This is the post-traumatic chainsaw midline neck contracture, and these are the multiple Z-plasties planned for the finger contracture. Thank you so much.